This morning, it was interesting because we had during the symposium many presentations. Some of them were about there was some kind of brain imaging with a hippocampus, and human beings have a hippocampus everywhere on the planet. In Egypt, in Singapore, in Germany, in United States, human beings have hippocampus. After, we had a talk about omega-3 fatty acids. Omega-3 fatty acids are the same in all countries on the planet. And we had also a talk about the question of the influence of Islam on dialectical behavioral therapy. And indeed, when you practice psychotherapy, you cannot practice them exactly in the same way according to the country where you are living. And I saw that it was very interesting for the audience. Many people say, yes, this is a very good question. And this, I see that in many countries. In many countries, when you have a conference, a congress, most researchers are speaking about some kind of pure child and adolescent psychiatry, which is the same all over the planet. And nowadays, from time to time, you have people who say, no, child and adolescent psychiatry cannot be the same all across the planet. There are specificities, and we have to work on this specificity. And because of that, I propose to you to discuss about the question of universalism. To what extent child and adolescent psychiatry is universal, and to what extent it is not? And what are the implications on the clinical practice? My conflict of interest, of course, I am European and I am French, and you know that there is a fantasy in France that there is that human beings are universal. So because this is my culture, this is likely to be a conflict of interest. I am a professor in biostatistics, that's life. So, you know, statisticians also have a particular way to see universalism. We will come back to that because there are a lot of statistics in medical research. And I like neuroscience and I like psychoanalysis too. And you will see that considering universalism, neuroscience and psychoanalysis are not on the same perspective as you can imagine. So, the main picture is that my belief is that at the moment, what feeds child and adolescent psychiatrist knowledge, at the moment, it is science. When you want to learn new things, you are reading international journal with impact factor, most often in English, that's life. It's a burden for you, because this is not your main language, and for me, this is not also my main language, but we have a common tongue, a common language about research in child and adolescent psychiatry. This is English, and these journals are scientific journals. And so science nowadays feeds clinical practice in child and adolescent psychiatry. Okay, but there is also the society. Politicians are asking us to give some care to youth. And politicians, of course, they have a cultural background. And you know, there is a complex interaction between science, society, and between science, society, and clinical practice. This is what we are going to see in the next minute. Now, we are going to see more precisely the influence of science on clinical practice. A long time ago, you remember that at the very beginning of medicine, you had an integrative and personalized medicine. If you consider 3,000 years ago, you had shaman, and shaman considered the patient within the family, within the community, within nature, within the cosmos, and spirituality. And this was very personalized And unfortunately, this was not really efficient. And then came Hippocrates, sorry. Oh my God. There it is. And then came Hippocrates who said, no, no, spirituality has nothing to say about medicine, especially in epilepsy. You know, seizure, epilepsy. It was considered that this patient, it was God who said, you have a disease. And Hippocrates said, no, no, no. God has nothing to see and to say about epilepsy. Epilepsy, it is a disease like myocardial infarction. So this is a big change, 2,500 years ago. And then, but Hippocrates, it was a progress, but not a complex progress. When you read his texts, the medication he proposed are a little bit awkward and not so efficient. And it took a long time to study the anatomy of human beings. And this was forbidden, you know, at the very beginning, it was forbidden to open a human body to look at what is inside. And you need to do that, to do science with anatomy to make progress in surgery. And so it took many, many hundreds of years to study anatomy. And then there was microscopy to look at the cells, the tissue. And then you had physiology. And at about the 19th century, modern medicine, and I would say modern Occidental medicine, arose, and it was indeed some kind of a progress. This is where we began to treat infectious disease with antibiotics. We had to find that infectious disease were due to germs, and then we had to find medication to kill the germs, to treat the patient. This is a physiological way to see medicine, and this has been a very important progress. But there has been a side effect. One side effect is that we have now in all countries, and this is universal, we have nephrologists, pneumologists, cardiologists, we have specialists of organs. And child and adolescent psychiatrists are a little bit embarrassed because of that, because what is our specialty? What is our organ? This is one point. The other point is that physicians consider that there is a universal law about what are diseases and what are patients. And this universal law comes from the fact that biology, in the mind of biologists, is something universal. Indeed, we are all made of atoms and molecules. And this is true. In Singapore, in France, in Egypt, we are made of the same carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. This is true. And we have all DNAs. And these are our DNA is based on the same molecules. And we have cells. And we have all a heart, a nose, some eyes. And so, on a biological point of view, people consider that we are exactly identical. Because we are made by the same molecules. We have the same physiology. Of course, you will say to me, no, in Egypt, we have some genetic particularities, and there is epigenetic, I know. No, no, okay, this is true. But on a symbolic point of view, we are made exactly on the same way. This is like the law of gravity of Newton, you know. This law exists all over the galaxy. This is universal. The way we are built is also considered to be universal if you read biological textbook. And of course, if we are similar, then we are identical. Now, during the 20th century, you know that something else happened in addition to biology. Evidence-based medicine happened. And evidence-based medicine is not based on biology. It is based on statistics. And this is really an epistemological split. But what say statistics? you know that when you do statistics, when you do a statistical study, you study a sample of patient. And this sample of patient is supposed to come from an underlying population. But you will see that in most papers, this underlying population is some kind of a fantasy. We never know exactly from which population come our sample. And I consider that implicitly, what authors consider is that their sample comes from the population of humanity. And this is the reason why, when they publish results, they say, we have found a relationship between childhood trauma and PTSD or borderline personality disorder. We have found that for humanity. Because I consider implicitly that my sample comes from humanity. So that what consider statistics, you know, statistics do propose conclusion about an average subject by definition. Statistics deal with average subject, and the problem is that in clinical practice you never face average subject. But this is another story. And so in fact, nowadays when you consider paper dealing with statistics, in fact the conclusion of the paper considers that all human beings are a clone of an average subject of humanity. And so this is some kind of very curious universalism. Statistics consider that we are in average like an average subject, which is completely absurd, but in average this is true. And what is curious is that it works. You know, if you follow evidence-based treatment, in average, this treatment works on patients. Everything works in average. And so there is some very specific kind to consider universalism when you speak about statistics. The second point is that, you know, evidence-based medicine has been designed especially or in particular for medication. And medication are industrial products. You know, two pills of 20 milligrams of fluoxetine are exactly the same. They are identical. And because of medication are so important in medicine, because medication are all identical, implicitly we consider that the treatment we provide are all either identical all over the planet. Indeed, 20 milligrams of fluoxetine are the same in Egypt as in Singapore. And there is a side effect. You have noticed that most people consider that the fact that a physician in Egypt or a physician in the United States prescribe 20 milligrams of fluoxetine, this has no particular effect on the future of the patient. I'm sure you have read many randomized controlled trials which evaluate medication. Did you see one randomized controlled trial where people wanted to see if a female doctor or a male doctor is more efficient, if an old physician is more or less efficient than a young physician, if a religious physician is more efficient than a non-religious physician? I never saw a randomized controlled trial where this question has been raised. Why? It is a real question. It is a real question. And why this question is not raised? Because we consider that medication are industrial and all identical. And in a way, all physicians are also identical, which is not true, of course. Concerning the society, and I would say Occidental society, because as you have noticed, Occidental culture is a little bit invading the whole planet at the moment. Even if things change for a couple of years, but this is mainly what happens. About 200 or 300 years ago, you have happened what is called modernity. And it came from mainly Occidental Europe, in Scotland, and with the French Revolution. And you can see here something famous, the Declaration of Rights of Man and the Citizen. And you see, men are born and remain free, this is fine, and equal in rights, equal in rights. Social distinction can be founded only on the common good. That is, there should be no distinction between human beings, and they are all equal. And this is a postulate. And because of the postulate, in the mind of people, if we are equal, then we are identical. And even some philosophers say, okay, human beings are not identical, but they have the same human condition. They have the same human condition, so we are identical, even if we were born in Egypt or in North America. And so, if we are all identical, society tells us that we have to consider all patients as being identical. This is a question of justice. Which is good. This is good, but this has a side effect. We cannot see that indeed patients are not identical because there is a social injunction to consider that they are identical. Then there has been the second modernity. Second modernity happens after the Second World War, about 1945, 1950. And what happens? It happens individualism and self-actualization. The individual becomes something very important in our society. You have noticed that, especially in young people. They have to exist by their own. This is something very important. And they have to become somebody, a star, in football or about the music. And because of that appears a notion of well-being. You know, the definition of health is well-being, the definition of mental health is well-being and self-actualization. And you can consider that, curiously, the notion of individualism, extreme individualism, becomes some kind of universalism. Because we are all specific, we are all human beings are specific, and so we share something in common, which is humankind, and we have also a specificity, and so the culture disappears because of specificity and individualism. And curiously, psychoanalysis is really okay with that. You know, when you are a psychoanalyst, you focus on the specificity of a human existence, of a human trajectory. Then you have what is called postmodernity, and this is today. I put quotes on postmodernity because this is some kind of a very fuzzy concept, and because we live in some kind of a fuzzy period. Anyway, about postmodernity, there is a question of globalization, you have noticed. This is obvious. You have the notion of cultural relativism. Cultural relativism is about, well, what is true in a country is not necessarily true in a country. What is true for women is not necessarily true for male, etc., etc., etc. And you have in this way many, 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 many type of communities, thousands, an infinity of way to consider community of human beings. And you have also this what is called the ideology of victimization. You know, now women are victim of male, which is true, which is true, which is true. But this is what happens in the media. If you cannot eat gluten, then you are a victim of the common way of taking food. If you are black or not black, then you are a victim. If you have some kind of religion, you are a victim because in your society this religion is not well considered. You have noticed that. You have noticed that communities exist nowadays because of victimization. And what is curious is that science has to take that into account in its rhetoric. And this is very funny to see how epigenetic function. You know, at the end of the 20th century, there was genetic everywhere. And it was a little bit cold, you know. If we are only genes, this is a little bit sad. This is not very human. And because of postmodernity, because of cultural relativism, genetic could not be a way to consider humanity. And in fact, geneticians created the concept of epigenetics on a scientific point of view, which is very strange, because what is epigenetics? It is all what is not genetic, you know, from the methylation of DNA to religion. And you know that you have an interaction between gene and what is not gene, that is environment. And if environment is what is not genetic, if you have an interaction between gene and what is not gene, then you have an interaction between everything, and so you say nothing. And in fact, the concept of epigenetics, of interaction between gene and environment, is empty on an epistemological point of view. This is just a way of rhetoric to consider the environment, but to use still the word genetics, because in epigenetics you have still genetic, and the word is important. Anyway, and about medicine, nowadays, in many countries, we have to take into account some specificity of communities. For instance, you know that in the US and other countries, you have some drugs for some anti-hypertensive drugs that are specifically designed for black people. And there is a biological argument for that. You know, black people in America were slaves and they came from Africa in boats. And many of the slaves died. They died from dehydration. And so those who survived, genetically, they were able to keep their sodium. And so the black people that live in America are likely to be able to keep their sodium. And so this is a risk factor of hypertension. And so this is a biological argument not to treat hypertensive black people like hypertensive white people. And you have also now people who say that we should not treat women with medication, women like men, because there are biological differences between women and men. And in psychiatry, and in child and adolescent psychiatry, you know that we have now the concept of neurodiversity in autism, in ADHD. When symptoms are not so severe, we shouldn't consider that these children have a disease or a disorder. We should consider that they are different. And for me, this is the most important revolution that happens in the last years, which has very direct clinical implication. More and more we have families who come with patients with mild symptoms, and the parents say, yes, but what is the diagnosis? What happens? We are able to say, there is no diagnosis. There is only a difference. He or she is different, and you can say to the teacher, he or she is different, and he has to take into account this difference. This is really peaceful for the patient-physician relationship. So postmodernity has some good aspects, some good impact in our clinical practice. But the crazy things is that postmodernity indeed works against universalism, but this is society which imposes how we have to consider cultural specificities. And societies are biased. You know, societies at the moment consider the gender issue, the racial issue, the spiritual issue. But we as physicians, we can see that we have some communities problems that we see that the society do not see. Okay. About clinical practice, what do we see every day? First, something I'm sure you have noticed, even if treatments are universal, efficacy is not universal. And very often, you have a patient with a clear-cut diagnosis, you have a treatment which is evidence-based for this diagnosis, you give the treatment to the patient, and the treatment does not work. And sometimes it is very difficult to explain that to the parents, you know, because you say, this is ADHD, this is typical, I have a treatment which is efficient for ADHD, this is evidence-based, you give the treatment and it does not work. And so, why? If this is efficient, if you are sure of the diagnosis, it should work on my kid, and it is not the case, so why? And of course you say, from time to time, it does not work. So, why do you say that this is evidence-based, if from time to time it does not work? Second point, DSM is universal, indeed. Indeed, in most countries, people use DSM or ICD. So this is universal by definition. But patients are not so universal. You have noticed. Schizophrenic patients do look like each other, but there is a huge heterogeneity among schizophrenic patients, which means that from time to time, you can consider them as bipolar and even from time to time, as autistic patient. I know that we are not supposed to say that today because autism is supposed to be very different from schizophrenia, but in clinical reality, who didn't ask the question, is it autism or is it schizophrenia? From time to time, this is not so easy, even if the diseases are supposed to be so different. And disease can vary according to culture. And not only considering psychiatric disease. In rheumatology, spondyloarthritis without radiological symptoms is not considered as a disease in the United States, and it is considered as a disease in Occidental Europe. And you have some psychiatric disease which are specific of Asia. For instance, the koro. The koro is a syndrome of retraction of genitals. Very curious. We have not that in Europe, never. And in China, this is something which is quite classical. And you have the hikikomori, you know, which come from Japan, which is some kind of isolation of adolescents. We stay at home, and this is not social phobia. This is not a schizophrenic form disorder. This is not school phobia. This is a new diagnosis that at the beginning existed only in Japan. And of course, in child and adolescent psychiatry, we have clusters. Age, of course. Infant, children, adolescent are three different specialties. Girls and boys, conduct disorder and ADHD in girls and boys are quite different. And societies also have their specific pattern of risk factors. For instance, you have societies where women have to be seen, you know that. And in societies where women have to be seen, the prevalence of anorexia nervosa increases. And you know that in some countries you have some specific religion, and you know that religion protects from addiction and from suicide attempt. And the side effect is very important. And in child and adolescent psychiatry, uniqueness is even more important than in other medical specialty. You know, two myocardial infarctions are more or less similar, but two families are always very different. You can do statistics with patients, doing statistics with family is something crazy. And in the same way, you know that the life trajectory of a youth, of a young people, is something very important to understand psychopathology. This is not only a psychoanalytic trick. This is just, you have to know what happens during childhood to understand the future of the youth. And a trajectory of a human being is something very specific. There is also the question of universality of mind. We are dealing with psychiatry. Psychiatry is about the specialties that deal with mental disease. But does the notion of mind exist in all cultures? And in a way, this has been studied by anthropologists, and the answer is yes. There is an anthropologist, Philippe Descola, who found that in all cultures, you have an opposition between what is called interiority, internal life, and physicality, the body. It exists in all cultures. But according to culture, the way that we share physicality or interiority can be different. For instance, in Occidental culture, and I guess in Egypt it can be the same, we consider that on a physical point of view we are identical. We are made by the same molecules. So we are identical, and this is the same for chairs or for the microphone. They are made of atoms, like us. But of course the microphone has no mind, and I have a mind. For animist people, the tree has a mind, the river has a mind. We share our mind with all what exists in reality. But obviously, on a physical point of view, we are not like a river, we are not like a tree, we are physically different. So this is about mind, but about spirituality. Spirituality is different from mind, and we have seen that in a presentation this morning. And of course, when you see patient or family who has a specific spirituality, and if this spirituality is not yours, then obviously you will have to take that into account. And there is also, in addition to spirituality, beliefs. Some family believe that medication are not good. You know that. Medication for kids are not good, even if it is antibiotics. Which, this is crazy, but this is a belief. And sometimes it is a very strong belief. And if you do not consider that, if you say this is crazy, you will give the prescription and the kid will never take the antibiotics and the kid will die. And so this is the real clinical question. So I arrive to the conclusion, in practice, how have we to deal with universalism and singularity? We have to consider first that we are using scientific theories, and these scientific theories are not neutral about universalism. And most scientific theory, in particular hard scientific theory, consider that all human beings are the same. And because we love science, there is a temptation that to consider that all our patients are identical, that there are no diversity. And this is the same. We live in societies, and our societies are not neutral about universalism. And because we are citizens, we are conditioned by that. So, okay, we live in societies, and we study science, okay. But we are clinicians, and we have the duty to take a step back and to look at science as it is, and our societies as they are. And after, to focus on our patient, on the family, for what they are in reality. So, and I think this is my last slide. The first practical thing is, us child and adolescent psychiatrists, we have to study the culture of other human beings. This is funny. This is very interesting. But this is a clinical necessity. And this is all the more a necessity as our patients come from very different cultures. And this is going to happen more and more because of migration. You know that for many reasons, migration are going to be a major issue in the next decades. And we already see that in my country. We have to face with patients who come from completely different cultures. And we do not see what happens within their family. And so what we say simply is not understood, because conceptually this cannot be shared. Our scientific way of thinking is incompatible with the culture of the kid. And so if we do not take that into consideration, what we do is nothing. We have to consider that our patients have belief, and we have belief. We have belief too. Our belief most often come from a scientific, come from science, and we love science and we consider that science tells the truth. We have to be a little bit careful about that. Science is good because science is efficient. This is true. Neuroscience gives knowledge. This is true. Evidence-based medicine is efficient. This is true. Do they tell the truth of psychopathology? This is another question. I am not sure there is some kind of truth about that. So, when we face some patients and some family with different beliefs, even if we consider that their beliefs come from middle age, are irrational, we have to accept that because this family lives in a different culture, their belief makes sense within their culture. And we have not to say that you are wrong to consider that the disease of your boy comes from the cosmos. The cosmos has no influence on of ADHD. This is not true. If this is the belief of the family, you have to say, okay, I am a physician, I am a psychologist, I have studied on the scientific point of view ADHD. On my point of view, it is problematic for me to understand what you say, but I acknowledge that this is what you consider, and I have to be humble about what I know. And okay, I accept what you say. I accept what you say, but you have to accept also that I have studied psychopathology. And you have to accept that my scientific knowledge is efficient to treat people. If you go to treat a myocardial infarction, science is good for that. And this is the same for child and adolescent psychiatry. So we have to respect each other, our own belief, and you have to respect too my scientific knowledge, because this will be good for your children. And this is, on my opinion, we do not teach that enough when we teach how to be a clinician. Sometimes it will be even more difficult. Sometimes, if we discuss, we cannot understand each other. And in this situation, we need a cultural mediation. A cultural mediation that is to do one or two big meetings with the whole family, even with the shaman. We accept everybody from the community, and we meet during 1 or 2 hours, and we speak. And my experience, and Professor Marie-Rose Moreau in Paris did that for many decades, and it worked quite well. When we discuss with the whole community, even with the shaman, if the shaman see that you recognize his knowledge, then the treatment of the patient will be much more efficient, because there will be a mutual recognition of expertise. We have to recognize, and this is an interesting and a difficult part of our job, there is a tension between what is universal. We have all dopamine in our brain. This is universal. And dopamine has to see with ADHD or schizophrenia. This is universal too. You have statistics. Evidence-based medicine is based on statistics. Statistics is a strange way to consider universalism. It's very strange, but it works. And so we have also to study statistics. There is also the common, that is what belongs to the community, to the religion, to the gender. Adolescents are a community, and so we have to understand that community have their specificity, and this specificity can be very important. And there is also singularity. Within a community, people are different. in their life, in their expectancy, and we have to find this specificity and to understand them. We have to take into account all this, and this is true for the clinic, for the research, and for the teaching. And thank you for your attention.